Welcome to the Minds of E-Commerce podcast, where you'll learn one key strategy that made leading e-commerce companies grow exponentially. We cut the bullshit and keep the meat. In a 15-minute episode, founders and executives take us through a deep dive of a strategy so you get to learn and grow your online sales. In the last episode, you heard from Nick Sharma, former director of direct-to-consumer e-commerce at Hint Water, who shared with us an ad strategy that helped Hint become a $100 million business, according to Forbes. Today on episode 6, get ready, Gareth Everard, co-founder of Rockwell Razors, Keto, and a few other e-commerce brands, will share how he calculates and utilizes the lifetime value of his customers to make paid ads ultra profitable and a key driver of profit for his business. I'm your host, Raphael Paulin-Daigle, and I'm the founder of Splitbase, a conversion optimization agency for lifestyle and fashion e-commerce brands. This is Minds of E-Commerce. All right, Gareth, welcome to the show. So as you know, this podcast, Minds of E-Commerce, is all about diving straight into your business and really understanding key strategies, or mostly one key strategies that our listeners can really learn from you and get, you know, all sorts of juicy, valuable insights so they can apply it to their business. So to get some context, you know, you're a serial e-commerce entrepreneur. When did you launch, or when did you start your first e-commerce brand, I should say?
Yeah, great question. I think it was about 5 years ago. It was my senior year at Western University, which is just it's a pretty big university down in kind of Southern Canada. It is a brand called Rockwell Razors. We make eco-friendly shaving products that focus on eliminating razor burn and ingrown hairs. So that's kind of how I jumped into it, with a crowdfunding campaign back in the early days of crowdfunding. We did like a $150,000 campaign, and the brands continued to grow from there. So Rockwell, 5 years later, we've got kind of a full management team in that company. It's chugging along. We do a good, healthy e-commerce and wholesale business. So that's a multi-million dollar company at this point. Somewhere along the way, I realized there was an opportunity beyond kind of shaving and beard products that Rockwell makes. You can check that out at getrockwell.com if you're curious about awesome. The whole line of products. We also have MrGladstone.com, which is Mr. Gladstone Solid Colognes. Similar space, but a different company. We make, obviously, cologne, but in a wax format. That started 2 years ago. That, I think, just hit the million-dollar mark itself. Really lean, small company, but it's been really fun. And about less than a year ago, I started a company called Keto, K-E-Y-T-O. And that's actually my first VC-funded kick at the can. So I'm a co-founder and CMO of that. We raised $2.5 million led by Kraft Ventures back in November. We did a crowdfunding campaign that did $1.2 million out of the gate. We shipped all of that product already. We're recording this in June 2019. So that's been great. We're doing the official launch here at the end of June, actually, right in 1 week from when you and I are recording this. So really excited, because we've already done over almost $2 million of revenue. And we're not even a year in, and we're just getting started. So I think that's amazing. That's a 30,000 foot view.
Yeah, that is super awesome. So obviously lots of companies, you're an overachiever, you've grown, you know, you've had very successful Kickstarter, or I should say crowdfunding. I'm not sure if it was on Kickstarter or not, but you've had some very large multi-million dollar crowdfunding campaigns. You've grown those companies to millions of dollars, both on online and wholesale. So your experience really reaches far and wide. So I'm super excited, because there's a lot of strategies that we can dive into. And I know we talked a little bit about this before this podcast recording, but I know one strategy that you've used to grow your business, and that for you has been just so important, has been to focus on paid ads, but on a cost per acquisition basis. So tell us more about that.
Yeah, so no, I'd be happy to. Actually, it's funny, because a lot of my brands originally grew just organically, just by word of mouth. There's always something that was very topical. So there's a lot of organic reach on that. But what I find is there's a lot of chatter nowadays about kind of out-of-house advertising, stuff that isn't super measurable right out of the gates. And for me, something that is incredibly measurable after you kind of get that piece from organic is really important. So in all of my companies, what I always make sure I have a very firm grasp on is LTV and average order value. And once you get there, you can actually exactly calculate down to the cent how much you can afford to pay to acquire a new customer. And once you have that, people are always thinking of new and fancy ways to acquire customers. But right now, advertising is a very consistent and reliable way. And instead of drilling down onto variable acquisition costs across different platforms, we've actually found that picking one number and then paying someone who specializes in that, paying a performance agency to take care of that, has been vastly rewarding. Because it really gets you kind of a fixed cost. And once you understand what your LTV and your margin is, you can really calculate exactly expected payback periods. And, nothing always goes perfectly according to plan, but it's been pretty good for us in the early days here.
Awesome. And Gareth, before we dive further, by talking with a lot of companies, I know that one thing that some e-commerce companies have a challenge with is calculating their LTV. Right. So there are many ways. I feel like everybody has a different way of calculating it, and yet it's supposed to be a pretty simple calculation. How do you look at it, and how do you advise people to look at their LTV when it comes to then using that metric for performance marketing?
Yeah, I mean, LTV, people start getting a little bit generous with it, especially in like pitch decks to investors, because they know, well, we're predicting that our LTV is going to be this. My suggestion would be, like, as conservative as you possibly think you can be, try to go even more conservative until you've got a consistent model that's working for you. So we actually pick probably comically low numbers, especially at Keto, as kind of our expected LTV internally, knowing that in reality, LTV is going to be substantially lower. So we think about like a 10% conversion to will this work at a 10% conversion to a second purchase? When in reality, we know that we're implementing levers that are going to get those numbers a little bit higher, because we're making a product that really serves people's needs and the reviews have been fantastic. So that's where I'd start. That's a little asynchronous to what some people would say, blow out the largest numbers that you possibly can, raise against those numbers. I don't know if that's necessarily the case I do, because we're looking to build businesses, not just things that kind of blow up VC's numbers. I'd take conservative LTV calculations, figure out why you're making those calculations, and go even more conservative, especially when you're still at that predictions stage and projections.
That's so important, because at the end of the day, when we're looking at this, if you're not being conservative with that number, you're probably just doing yourself a disservice, right? Because at the end of the day, if you're trying to optimize your campaigns, your metrics, and your business based on an inflated number, and then you're falling short of those expectations, you may just be deploying the wrong strategy based on the wrong numbers.
That's probably why CMOs have the highest turnover out of any position. It's tough.
Totally. So let's go back to your acquisition strategy. So what are a few things? So let's say someone really wants to shift to, looking at their acquisition model on a cost per acquisition basis based on their LTV. What are some of the key things that someone should look for as they're building out that strategy and growing their business?
Really, you have to drill down into, so the lever that you'll need to know right up front is what your average basket is. This can get a little complicated if you're like, Rockwell and Keto are very different businesses, because Rockwell has like 70 SKUs. Keto is one. As of this recording, Keto is one. So Keto, we can really predict the margin on the average basket, because the average basket is pretty consistent. The margin is consistent every single time. On the other hand, if you're like a multi-SKU retailer, which I'm sure many of the people are who are listening to this, you really have to drill down to what your average margin on your average basket is, and ultimately kind of make this stress testing for which way can it go. So for example, like Rockwell's margin on some of our consumables are lower than the average razor. So if someone comes in and orders like six tubs of shave cream, the margins are going to be very different than they are if they ordered two razors, even though the basket is going to actually be the same size. So right. You ultimately need to figure out what orders, the velocity of what certain orders look like, drill down into what your margin room is, and then again, being conservative with that, try to find someone who will work with you on a performance basis on a CAC that works in all situations or create rules on the back end. So for example, in the performance agency we're working with for Rockwell, we've created rules that they actually were doing exclusions to certain product bundles, and they're not pushing traffic to those, so that we're excluding things that ultimately don't make sense in our model, because that's where people really get tied up. If you're assuming that people are always going to buy a 3-pack of your sunglasses, just for example, and it turns out your performance agency is driving mostly 1-pack sales, you're going to be wondering where all of your money went, and it's because you're not actually making the margin that you expected, and you're paying out commissions that are pretty high. So understanding margins would be seriously understanding margins would be absolutely the place to start.
Got it. And that's super, super important. And I would even say, you know, obviously if it's something that, you know, for whoever's listening to this, if it's something you're doing yourself, get help from someone who's an expert at this, right? There are so many great people that can help you figure out all the numbers. If you're not my strength is not in all the crazy numbers when it comes to this, but there are, you know, the good thing is that there are people that specialize in that, and that can help you out with it. Garth, that is super key. But now, you know, obviously it is a more complicated model than, you know, some people sometimes will just go and launch campaigns and they won't even think of their margins. And then they realize only at the end of the quarter or whatever, oh shit, our profit's in the minus. Yeah. Right? And that's when they're realizing at the end of the day, it doesn't matter if you're making $1 million a month, but you know, if you're not really taking, you know, account of your margins and your acquisition costs and your strategy, I mean, it's just, you know, business e-commerce 101, you're not going to make money. So tell us, what are some of the biggest mistakes that people usually do when they're trying to apply that model? Because, you know, it's probably not something that you get right from the first time. There's still, you know, a little bit of trial and error.
That's a great question. Actually, it's funny what I've seen people forget a lot is, forgetting the difference between cost and landed cost. Landed cost, the difference, especially I'm really drilling down into physical e-commerce right now. But landed cost, for example, if you're ordering from China, there's been all sorts of crazy tariff stuff going on recently. So the difference between buying, well, I'll go back to sunglasses. If your sunglasses cost $2 to make in your factory in China, and you're just getting started, and you're importing by air, which is obviously at a higher cost, or if you're not just getting started, but rushing in that inventory, plus you're being hit with a new duties rate, those sunglasses could cost substantially more than $2. And if you're putting, I mean, now we're almost getting into accounting, but like if you're putting other things into expense columns, like duties and freight into expense columns, rather than rolling those costs back into the per SKU level, you're actually going to end up having a very different idea of your margins, because those costs are not being allocated to that SKU. So wherever you're tracking your per unit cost may not be reflecting the true margin you're ultimately making on taking on that inventory. So I think that's one of the, that's an interesting spot I've seen people forgetting to include freight, forgetting to include duty in their cost per unit in their COGS.
That's where it starts. Miscalculating margins is that's what you would say.
That would be bad. Yeah.
At the end of the day, make sure that, you know, all your costs are actually factored in into your margin calculations.
Yeah.
Super important. Now, let's say somebody wanted to start, you know, all right, we're going and we're launching this strategy. They can obviously either do it in house or, you know, hiring an agency. Now, I know you've done both. You've explored, you know, a lot of different worlds when it comes to this. You've touched base a little bit on how people could do it in-house. But I want to know, let's say you would go and would decide to work with an agency. How do you find an agency that values this? What are the main things to look for when hiring an agency to run these campaigns?
What I found is I think now we're seeing a lot of people starting e-commerce companies in specific niches. And typically, performance agencies are now specializing in different niches. So we're working with two different companies, one for Rockwell and one for Keto, not because they were the performance agencies. There are some that are better than others, but when they have a certain expertise in a particular area, like there were a few companies that our agency for Keto is already working with that we were like, oh, like this is a no-brainer. If they're working well for them, and you ask their client, you get kind of testimonials or make sure that you do a reference check, obviously, all the time, do reference checks. that they're working well with people in a similar space but non-competitive, you definitely want to proceed there. So there are lots of good resources to find ideas for performance agencies, especially if you're in direct to consumer, like if you're a subscriber to 2PM or you follow 2PM or any of those kind of direct to consumer outlets on Twitter or anything like that, it's inevitable you'll come across lots of people who are in that performance agency space. And it's really up to you to just reach out, find who they're working with, get testimonials, make sure that they're crushing it for people who are in a similar vertical, but not exactly the same, obviously, because it'll be tough if they already have a, you know, if you're a glasses company and they're doing performance marketing for Warby Parker, that's going to be bad.
Yeah. Awesome. Love it. And I couldn't agree more. You know, as the owner of a conversion optimization agency that specializes in fashion, lifestyle, and beauty, you know, I think it gives an advantage that, you know, we know what's normal and we know what's not normal. We know what works. We know what doesn't work, you know, compared to an agency that literally works for everyone else. You can get much more granular, and the agency will be much more familiar with what you're selling. So,
of course.
Fantastic. So Gareth, now let's say we step back and we're looking at, you know, all the different things you've done inside your company. So you've, like you said, you've got, you know, a company with Keto with one product for the moment, and then with Rockwell Razors where you've got over 70 SKUs. What are some other really interesting tricks that maybe people don't really know about that you've used to grow these companies?
Well, I know we just talked about this, so I know you have another episode coming out with someone who will be able to speak to this better than me, but I'm a big believer in testing products before you release them any way that you possibly can. So I'll actually go back to Rockwell for this one. Before we released any major new razor product, that's kind of like our flagship. So obviously the company is called Rockwell Razors. We make a bunch of stuff, but mostly razors. So we would do a crowdfunding Kickstarter or Indiegogo campaign before releasing any new razor. And we've been fortunate that those campaigns have all been fairly successful in the hundreds of thousands of dollars range. So we've been able to kind of proceed with those projects. But if any of those had come back negative, we wouldn't have done them. We actually did axe one razor SKU because there was one finish. I think we were going to make something in rose gold and not enough people bought that. So we were like, forget it. We don't. Clearly, there's not enough demand right now. And then after those campaigns, we use a service called BackerKit, which is where people can manage their address for their crowdfunding purchases, because people move. If there's like six months between when they pledged and when it's shipping, they'll move. So we actually used BackerKit to put ideas for new products. When we were originally coming out with our Shave Green beard oils and all that, we put all those ideas in BackerKit and let people pre-order those there. And it let people vote with their wallets on what additional products we should be making. So everything that we've ever done has been sort of from at least a marginally educated perspective. And we've done that with Keto too. I can't quite announce yet because we haven't released those products, but we have done some testing and some speaking with our customers about what other products they'd be interested in seeing Keto make. So when you have an audience, you have the ability to make sure that you're connecting with that audience to make the new products that they're looking for. Right. I mean, you can build this out to like influencers, understanding which influencers they identify with, and then what other influencers you could possibly look at working with as a result of that, where they spend their time. Like there's so much just by engaging with and speaking with your audience and understanding what you can do that would add value or to resonate with them more. That I think that's something that I've done an okay job of over the years. So I would encourage anyone to do that just to make sure you're building a company of value.
Amazing. Awesome. I asked that question. I wanted you to talk a little bit about this because I know that it's a big part of your story. And now in a very linear way, you know, if we look at, you know, for people listening, if we're looking at how Gareth is growing his companies and how he's evolving with the products, you know, he starts by validating the products, you know, mostly by using crowdfunding campaigns, and then a lot of tools to, you know, like you mentioned, what is that tool you said to keep addresses
available? BackerKit.
BackerKit. You know, that's been pretty critical in that, obviously, as people move and shipping timelines sometimes expand. But then as you've gotten the products and then, you know, really worked on growing the companies, focusing on the actual understanding your margins, right, is really a
base of it all, where when you understand that, you know how much you can spend to acquire people. And then when you really understand your cost of acquisition, you can run campaigns knowing that, hey, I can say profitable or not. And I'm not going to recap his whole strategy because it goes quite in depth. I think you'll just have to rewind a little bit or read the transcription of this. But you know, Gareth's strategy is just pretty fantastic and very smart. So Gareth, thank you so much for sharing this. Thanks for coming on the show, and see you soon in possibly another episode where we're going to dive even deeper.
Awesome, man. Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right.
Okay.
All right, that's it for today's episode. In the next episode, you'll hear from Phil Kiprianou, founder of Gothrider, and you'll learn how he's been using quizzes as a traffic acquisition and conversion strategy that has been adding millions of dollars to his company's bottom line. To make sure you don't miss any of the new episodes, subscribe to the podcast, and if you've liked what you've heard, make sure to leave a review in the iTunes store. That would truly mean the world to me. Now, if you're working on an e-commerce store that does over $1 million in online sales and increasing conversions is a priority, make sure to go to splitbase.com/assessment. That's splitbase.com/assessment to get a free analysis of your website and find out what's the number one action item our conversion experts recommend that you do next to boost your website conversions. If you have any guest requests, questions, or comments, tweet me at rpaulindaigle. That's rpaulindaigle. And I'll be super happy to hear from you. Thanks again for listening. This is Minds of E-Commerce.